Since a few people asked me for it, I have also made a video on the decision-making section of XAT 2022, but I'm not sure about the answers, hence I've not made a table for this particular video like in the GK one. So I'll be discussing individual questions instead and what my rationale was behind my choices and what I feel are the most plausible and correct options. So the first case was of Raghubir's SUV. Where Raghubir is a reputed doctor who practices medicine in a tier 3 city. He owns an imported SUV which he had bought 10 years ago using his hard-earned savings. Now, initially, he used to use it for long rides, but for the last 6 to 7 years, he was only using it for his daily commute, which was a 10-minute drive from his home. The SUV had been his proud possession, and we understand that it requires a lot of maintenance. It's also diesel guzzling, that is, it consumes a lot of diesel. So it does not comply with the new emission norms which are being introduced in tier 1 and 2 cities. Of late, some newspapers are reporting that the new emission norms will be introduced in tier 3 cities as well. Now this news has worried Raghubir. Now please take note of the parts that are in bold. These are key facts. So the question is that Raghubir is afraid that if the emission norms are rolled out, he will not be able to use his SUV anymore. So what can assuage his fear? So the answer for this should be option number D, because option number A is not something that completely assuages his fear, right? Because even if there are many other SUVs, first of all, you do not know whether all of them are also non-compliant with the emission norms. And secondly, even if they are non-compliant with emission norms, it does not mean that there is a laxation in the law that will be there because of that reason. Because emission norms, when they come out, they will be forcing all SUVs like that to be changed in some way. So that is not a good enough reason. Option number B and E are very unethical because they are trying to imply that because he is a doctor and he has friends who are lawyers or law enforcement officials, there'll be partial treatment towards him, which again we discard. Option number C we cannot accept because we do not know how credible his mechanic is. Like, who is his mechanic to assure him that the new norms are not being introduced? Option number D, however, gives him some ease. If there are non-compliant SUVs in tier 2 cities, plying means in large quantities, then that means that okay, the enforcement is happening but at a slow pace. So for some time at least, he can be rest assured about the fact that even if these norms come into play, he can still continue using his SUV for some time. Question number 2 talks about how Raghubir's daughter is concerned and unhappy about the diesel guzzling SUV and wants him to be more environmentally responsible. So she wants to dissuade him from using the SUV on a daily basis. So how does she do that? Now there are a few answers which are quite good for this. So option number B can be eliminated easily because Raghubir has been very proud of his SUV. That is something that was there in the fact of the entire case, that Raghubir is very proud of his possession. So obviously, getting him a new SUV might not be a great option. Similarly, giving him a small petrol car seems like a worse option. Among the three options, A, C, and E, E seems like a very right option because if the SUV can be retrofitted with a CNG kit, then that means Raghubir gets to keep his SUV and at the same time he does not have to worry about non-compliance with the emission norms because now it will be fitted with CNG. But option A and C also seems very close because option A is talking about Raghubir not using the SUV for daily use, which again is dissuading him from using the SUV on a daily basis, which was the objective. However, it is not very likely that Raghubir is going to use public transport after using an SUV for 10 years. Option C seems a little better because option C talks about how Raghubir's secretary can ferry him to the clinic daily in her car. But what we have seen as a pattern is that generally the answers that are chosen as correct are the ones which imply some kind of an individual responsibility of the decision maker. And the moment you're asking the secretary to ferry him to the clinic daily in the car, you're kind of giving away that responsibility to somebody else. So that is why I think option number E is the best option. But if not E, the answer will probably be C. Now, number three, this is a very confusing kind of a question overall, because the factors that are there are very, very, you know, they're very interlinked, obviously, and hence you can see even the options are quite close, and it depends on the kind of assumptions you take. So I believe that since the case talked about how important the SUV is to Raghubir, the first and most important factor should have been option number Q, which is how a new electric SUV in the market, which is within his budget, has the same look and feel of his present SUV. So that kind of a change factor is reduced. People do not like change a lot. They don't want to keep changing their belongings. And Raghubir is attached with his SUV. So if he can have an SUV which is very similar to his, then Q makes sense. Next, option number T makes sense, because when you talk about how Raghubir's SUV can be traded in at a reasonable price, then that means that not only is he getting a new EV, he's also able to get rid of his old one and get a good enough price for that. The next option would be how EVs within Raghubir's budget can cover his daily commute but not the long rides. Now, this is not a very important factor, obviously, because we know that for the past few years, he was not going on long rides anyway. So this is not a very important factor. And option number R, that EVs cannot be driven beyond the speed of 70 km/h, also does not seem like a strong enough option, because we understand that for daily commute, you do not really need a speed that is above 70 km/h. That seems like too much to have. So again, that does not feel like a very important factor. The main tricky part, I think, here was option number C, which is that new charging stations will be coming up on the main highway which connects his city to the closest metro city, which may come up in another year. Now, this can be dicey, but from what we understand from the case, that is, Raghubir is not going on long drives and he's only using it for his daily commute mainly, we can say that this is also not a very important factor. So considering that, P, S and R have been kept towards the end, and Q and T come before that. So QT, PSR made the most sense to me for this particular question. The next case was that of Aparna at A2Z. A2Z is a state-funded engineering college which is renowned for teaching and placements, but now it's aspiring to be a global leader in research. Therefore, A2Z decided to push for better quality research from the newly recruited faculty members. So in the past, some faculty members were confirmed because of the exceptional teaching, even if their research output was low. Currently, the dean, along with a consultation with the academic council, has decided that there will be a mandatory requirement of a quality of research along with teaching excellence for the confirmation of newly recruited faculty members, who will be first put on a probation for 3 years. And then confirmed, or their probation can be extended, or their services can be terminated based on their teaching and research contributions. Once confirmed, their job is secure along with another additional perquisites. So Aparna is one person that we are talking about who joined the social sciences department 2 years back. She is amongst many faculty members recruited after the new norms. Now, she completed her doctorate from a reputed university with significant research contribution. But after joining A2Z, she got deeply involved with the COVID-19 social outreach. And because of that, her research contributions are null and her teaching effectiveness has been negatively impacted. Her confirmation is due in a year. So she has completed 2 years of probation. This was, I think, the trickiest case of all. Let's see. So for the fourth question, we see that the dean realizes that the research contribution of Aparna needs considerable investment of time and efforts. He is concerned that the performance could set a wrong precedent for the new faculty recruits. So the dean wants to communicate to the new faculty that research contribution is critical. How does he do that while being fair to Aparna? So first of all, let's eliminate the bad options. We eliminate option B, that is, we suggest Aparna to start looking for a new job because that's extreme and also unrequired. Option number C does not seem very actionable.
Exhorting, that is requesting Aparna to suspend her social outreach activities till the end of her probation and focusing on research and teaching instead, does not seem like it's a very great option because it's not very actionable, because it's just a request and it's not very actionable per se, and it's not really helping her in any way. In comparison, we see option number E, where you appreciate her social outreach, but you advise her to focus on research and teaching contributions. Now, this in comparison to C seems better, because asking her to suspend her social outreach activities might not be a great idea at all, because if she is doing that and she is finding satisfaction in that, she will probably not stop it for this particular reason, because we understand that she is quite qualified as it is. So maybe E is a good mediation option, but personally I believe A or D would be a better option. Now, A talks about increasing her teaching and research requirements while extending her probation period by 2 years. And D talks about increasing her probation by 1 year while reminding her about the research and teaching contributions needed for confirmation. I believe D is the best option to be selected here, because A talks about increasing the requirements while extending the probation by 2 years. So now what he's saying basically is that right now her research is zero, and there's only 1 year left for her probation. Let's give her 2 years more. She'll have 3 years in total, and she'll have an increased responsibility for teaching and research. On the other hand, option number D shows that she has 1 year left. We'll give her one more year, so she'll have 2 years in total, and we'll remind her about the research and teaching contributions needed. What happens in the latter is that you're telling her, you're communicating it to her, that her teaching contributions and research contributions have to be increased. At the same time, you're giving her one more year so that she can prove herself. And that overall seems like a more fair option as compared to option number A, where you're extending it by 2 years entirely and you're increasing her requirements, which might not be fair to Aparna. Hence, option D seems like the best option to me. For question number 5, we see that 1 year on, Aparna continues with her social work. She gets closer to the end of her probation. She has not shown her teaching and research contributions, but her social work was widely appreciated. The chief minister wants her to take a larger role in social outreach and assist the government. The dean is afraid that if he does not confirm Aparna, then that might prompt her to leave the institution, and that would send a wrong signal to the outside world. This is basically a negative PR that would happen towards the institution, that if somebody is doing good social work, then the institution is just letting her go. So that might not be a great image to portray to the outside world. So what is a suitable option, action that can be taken by the dean? Now, first of all, we eliminate option number C and D. We eliminate C because it's not a fair option. The moment you say that this particular person is extraordinary and can be treated exceptionally, you also cause a kind of a hole in the entire system that is there. If you have a policy in place and you create an exception, then in the future, you might give way to several more exceptions. And the more exceptions you have, the lesser compliance you have with the original policy. So that does not follow. Option number D, again, is not a very good option to have, because why would Aparna even accept it? That is also something you have to think about as the stakeholder concerned. Aparna might not accept that kind of a contractual position where she'll have to leave irrespective of her contributions. Moreover, that would not incentivize her to increase her research contributions at all, and she might not do it. Option number A seemed like a good option because you're talking about how you're terminating her from a teaching position and creating a non-teaching position of outreach officer. But then the question is, does an engineering college need an outreach officer? And does Aparna want to do it? Because Aparna has clearly shown her apprehensions about not being able to take a teaching position, right? Like, she obviously might not like the idea of not teaching. So that again is something that does not seem very right. Between B and E, there's a very strong tie, because option B talks about confirming her but freezing her increments and promotions until her research contributions are as per expected standards. So what happens in this case is that Aparna is confirmed. So the PR crisis is managed. The outside world sees that Aparna has been confirmed, and that's completely okay. But her promotions will not be there unless she can improve her research contributions. So that also incentivizes Aparna to go on and contribute more. However, the moment you confirm Aparna, you cannot terminate her anymore because she has job security then and she has her rights. So again, you do not have a guarantee that she is going to increase her research contributions. Option E, however, is better in that regard because you're extending her probation by 3 years, which was the original amount, and you're telling her that she'll have to leave if the research and teaching do not improve in that period. So what happens in this case is that Aparna is very fairly treated. She gets an opportunity to prove herself. Moreover, the entire thing is also there. The availability of terminating her remains, which was not there in option number B. That's why I think option number E is the best possible option for 5. For question 6, Aparna in an interview expresses fear that she might be let go by A to Z, and this would obviously signal a PR crisis. So the academic council urges the dean to review the faculty confirmation policy. The dean, however, believes that if they change the policy, then that will be a setback to the institute's aspiration of becoming a global leader in research. So what is the best possible action that the dean can take? Firstly, let's eliminate the bad options. We eliminate option number A because the moment you do something like that, you're basically waging war. And who do you think is going to win? A big shot dean of an engineering college or Aparna, who was clearly appreciated by the media and the CM for social outreach? Does not work. Option C again is very extreme, that she's being let go for insulting, because first of all, we know that she did it by mistake, right? That's what inadvertently means. Moreover, that is not really a great thing to do. And again, that's also a distortion because she did not really insult the college at all. She just expressed a fear. So completely eliminated. Option number E is about confirming Aparna, which is not a good option because you cannot confirm Aparna because she has become very publicly popular, right? The moment you do something like that, it sends a wrong signal. It sends a wrong signal that because you're popular, we are taking you in. And in the future, that also creates a leeway, right? That also creates a leeway to further problems. And the policy such that you can become a global leader in research is compromised. So option E is also eliminated. Between option B and D, firstly, we see option B. So Aparna is being confirmed, but it's being made clear that her future promotions will be tied to her research contribution. Option D talks about conveying to Aparna that the institute is eager to retain her, but emphasize she should focus on research to get confirmed. So option D, what it does is, it does not confirm Aparna, but it also assuages her fear. Because Aparna was talking about her fear. So you're assuaging her fear by saying that we want to retain you, but you need to focus on research because that is what we need. So in that way, you still have the possibility of letting her go if she still does not improve. At the same time, you remove the fears from her mind and you remove any chances of a PR backlash. So option D seems like the best possible option for 6. Next case is of Dilip's Dosan. So Dilip Dosan is selling two varieties of dosas in front of a hospital. And he's selling a plain dosa for 25 rupees, masala dosa for 40 rupees. And his major clientele are the hospital staff members who mostly hail from South India. So the staff members frequented the stall during office hours because the dosas are reasonably priced. And they can visit the upscale food court on top of the court of the hospital. But they prefer his stall for breakfast and lunch. And even for the evening snacks, etc. Not very relevant. So his daily sale volume varies between 300 and 400 dosas and the demand is 50 to 60%. The numbers here are not very important because you do not really need to analyze that in any question. Option number 7 is about Dilip finding a vacant spot in the food court and he's wondering if he can shift his stall to that spot. So what can dissuade him from shifting his stall? Very clear cut answer is E, because all the other options are positive points, right? Option A. All other restaurants are selling North Indian meal. So that obviously means that there's a market opportunity. Everybody else is selling North Indian. I will be selling South Indian. There's a differentiation. So people will come to my stall. B talks about how the cheapest dish is priced at 200 over there. So if you are selling at a lower price, you can attract customers by that price itself. Moreover, as people are ready to pay 200 rupees as the cheapest price, they'll be willing to pay more for your items also, which is again a good thing. Option C talks about how the food court has no other stall selling dosas. Great, that means you do not have competition. Option D talks about a daily footfall of 5,000 people, which again is great. So only option number E, which talks about how he'll have to close earlier than what he currently does, might dissuade him from shifting his stall. Question number 8, Dilip shifts his stalls to the hospital food court and now he has increased his prices, right? So plain dosa has gone up from 25 to 40 and masala dosa has gone up from 40 to 60. But now he's saying that he's only serving 150 dosas per day, right? So his entire revenue has gone down. And this has happened why? Probably because his prices have gone up and the hospital staff, as we saw in the case, liked him because of his lower prices. So now he's selling lesser dosas. And now he's seeing that the clientele is still the same staff members. So he has not been able to attract new people here. So what does he do now? He can either introduce a North Indian meal and give discount to hospital staff members, which does not seem very reasonable. It does not seem like a good idea because there are already several people selling North Indian and his clientele is basically South Indian and that's why they are eating from him. So it does not make sense to do that. Option B talks about reducing price for 20% for hospital staff and increasing by 50% for others. This might make sense, right? This might be a good idea. This might be a good option because we understand that maybe hospital staff is not buying from him anymore because of his increased prices. So this might actually attract customers. But there is a possibility factor involved here, right? So what if he is not able to increase more people coming to his stall? What if that happens? In that situation, he is selling the price, the individual items at lesser prices and he's also selling lesser items. So the entire revenue stream is reduced. So that's not a good option for that to happen. Option C talks about increasing price of all food items by 50% and introducing new Sherkan dosa. Not a good option because already you're seeing you're selling less items. It does not make sense to increase prices further. Option number E was talking about how you introduce a South Indian meal at a discounted rate of 40 per plate. Now this seems like a fairly good option. This could be the correct answer. But I think D is a better option because in D what you do is you reduce your plain and masala dosa prices to 25 and 40 respectively, which was your old prices. So you might expect the staff members who had left you to come back. Moreover, you're adding more varieties of dosas at higher price points. So what happens now is you are gaining back the customers who you lost. Plus, you might actually be making more revenue because you now have items that are costlier. So there are a lot of opportunities involved here. So I'm not sure about this, but option number D seems like the best possible answer for this question. For question 9, we see that at the first anniversary of his stall, Dilip reviews his customer base. He sees almost all of them are staff members. He's trying to understand why that's happening and he realizes it's because people think it's a staff canteen. So now he thinks, what can I do to discourage hospital staff members from visiting his stall so that he can increase his overall revenue? Now here, option B, C and D are instantly eliminated, right? B talks about prohibiting staff from entering the food court. That does not work at all. Option C talks about introducing a massive discount on price for the next 2 months to increase footfall, which would not address the problem at hand, which was about how there were many staff members. Option D was charging the staff members a premium to offset losses due to their presence, which might or might not work. There's a lot of contingency involved. Between option A and E, we see option A, where he's appealing to the hospital management to give a space in the staff room where he can set an exclusive dosa counter. Now, this seems like a very good option, right? You can set up a dosa counter in the staff room so that the staff room people can just eat over there. However, that would need you to take this assumption that you are serving there and at the same time, you're also serving in the food court. And we do not know if that is happening. We do not know whether Dilip is actually running a place, he's running his business in both of those places. And if he's not doing that, then it would not make any sense to do that because then you're not able to increase more revenue. Option E, on the other hand, talks about providing a discount to staff members if they order on their phone and he can deliver food in the staff room. This seems like the safest and best option possible Because here, staff members are incentivized to order on phone so that their food can be delivered in the staff room. So this would obviously reduce the traffic of staff at the food court, and that might increase his visitors there. So option E seems like the best answer for 9. So the next case is about Sundaresan, a professor of corporate responsibility at a management institution. And he has a project that he's taking of his students. And while it was initially an individual assignment, some students sought permission to work on assignments as a team. He knows that collaboration fosters peer learning, so he allows it. So there are a few teams of 2 members, few of 3 members, and few who are working individually. The numbers here do not matter. For the first question, we see that the assignment deadline has come close and he's approached by a particular student who was working in a team of 3 members, that one of the team member was distressed because of the death of her grandmother and could not work on her bit of the assignment. So Abbas requested for a deadline extension so that she could finish her part of the assignment. But by then, many students who were working had already submitted their assignments. Like the students who were working alone had already submitted, and now they're asking for an extension. So what is the most appropriate option here? So we see these options. Option A was eliminated because the moment you say that Venkamma is going to work individually and other two are sticking to the original deadline as a team, that does not really work out very well. Because the moment you do that, you are removing the kind of collaboration and the peer learning that you were trying to encourage in the very first place. So that does not work out. Moreover, they have been working on it. So now disbanding the team is a little unfair towards Venkamma also. Option C is obviously also eliminated because you cannot really expect each student to work individually now at this point when other students have already started submitting, because that would require you to split an individual assignment into 3 different assignments. And working on that in a very short time period would not be possible. Option D seemed almost correct because yes, certain issues should be handled within the team, but the word warning just gave it a negative connotation to it. Moreover, there is the empathy factor that is involved. If Abbas has contacted the professor, he did that out of certain expectations of empathy from the professor, and this would probably signal a complete lack of such empathy. So D does not seem like a good option then. Between option B and E, option E seemed better for one clear reason. Option B talks about extending a deadline, but imposing a 1-grade penalty for the deadline extension, which seems fair because you're submitting it late and you're getting a penalty for it. But option E talks about giving a deadline extension, but adding an extra assignment as a new requirement. So the difference between B and E is that B is more penalizing in nature, while E is adding on work. And E just seems like a better or fairer option because we understand that since it's a team, it's not fair to the other team members that because of one team member, they are facing a 1-grade penalty. But if they have an additional assignment, then they can work on it as a team together. The collaboration and peer learning and takes place. And they're also facing some kind of a punishment. So it's not that they're extending and they're being let go entirely. So option E seems like a good option, but option B is also there. So either of these should be the answer. For the next question, Sundaresan is going to grade the assignments now, and he receives a request from the CR that the students who worked individually want extra marks because they handle the entire workload. So what is an appropriate action? So the answer for this should be A, for one very clear reason. You cannot change the rules in the middle of the game, and you definitely cannot change it after the game is over. That is to say, if such kind of a differential grading was to be done, then this should have been communicated at the very start of the project. So right when it started, the students should have been informed about this, and they should have been given the option accordingly, that if you want to work in teams, beware that you will not be marked as much. And maybe then people would make different decisions. But if you suddenly decide to grade people differently now, then that becomes entirely unfair. So that does not make sense. Question number 12. There has been some plagiarism And that is why two teams have been awarded an F grade for copying. Later that evening, somebody from team 9, Ashi, calls and admits that she had shared the exhibits and charts with Anvi. She said that Anvi could not put her efforts because of COVID-19 and requested for help. Anvi had assured Ashi that she would not copy it entirely. So Ashi now requests Sundaresan to punish her and Anvi and spare the others who are not involved. So here, option number A, B and D are eliminated because of this reason. Option A talks about giving them an extra assignment to avoid an F grade, which is not fair to the other team members who are not involved in anything, and is also too lenient towards towards Anvi, who has clearly been very unethical and has plagiarized, which is a terrible thing to do in academics. Option B does not make sense. This is not a movie, this is the real world. And even if a confession has been made, that does not mean that the teams get spared for that reason. Option number D, the teams should still be punished by giving an F grade. Now, this seems too harsh considering the fact that the teams were not really knowing about this entirely. Other team members of Ashi could not have possibly known that she had actually shared such documents with Anvi. So that seems harsh and unfair towards them. Option E is punishing only Anvi, because she is the one who is unethical involved here. Option C, on the other hand, is awarding an F grade to both Ashi and Anvi and sparing the others. And this seems like the best option possible. The reason for that is that while Anvi is obviously clearly unethical in reproducing the content, Ashi is not a great person either, because she shared those exhibits without asking her team members and jeopardized their situation. Because of Ashi, the entire team could be receiving a failing grade. And that is something that she should be made responsible for. Hence, it makes sense to punish both Ashi and Anvi and be fair to others by sparing them. The next case was about a cash crunch in school, that is, of future leaders. This is this particular prestigious private school in a small town, and you have a particular annual fee structure. This is not really very necessary. The next paragraph is, so, because of the coronavirus pandemic, classes turned online and local authorities mandated that the fee should be reduced by 20%. Further, parents should be allowed an extended time to pay the fees if they are in financial distress. Very important term. 6 months into the academic year, only 40% of the students had paid even the reduced amount of fees. Okay, so you see that 20% fees has already been reduced. On that, only 40% people have paid. So that obviously creates a bad situation. Now, first question is about Ajay Biswas, the rector, being alarmed by the shortfall. He does not want to trouble parents who are genuinely in distress, but he feels that there are some parents who are taking advantage. What can he do to have financially capable parents pay the fees? Option A is sharing through local newspaper that school is facing financial crunch and may have to close down. This might be an okay option, but this is not the best option here, because even if he does share that, that does not mean that that newspaper will be read by people. That does not mean that even if people read that, they are compelled to pay, because there's this entire mentality among people that I don't have to be the one who pays. I don't have to be the one. Whenever there's a group involved, people tend to piggyback on others. People believe that other people will pay, I will not have to pay. So because of that, A is not a great option. Option B is about offering 10 and 5% discount to parents paying fees. This just does not seem very right. It does not seem very right, because since we are talking about school fees, not some product delivery, offering a discount does not seem very right. Option number D is entirely stupid, because you cannot be giving marks to students because they have paid the fees. That is entirely discriminatory towards those students who are in genuine financial distress and cannot pay the fees. Option number E is like an okay option when you have parents being called every 3 days and they're being asked to pay the fees. But again, this might just be mockery, right? Because there are parents who are in genuine distress, and being heckled every 3 days is not only a lot of time and effort being spent by the school, which might be entirely wasteful, it's also very disrespectful and shameful for those people who can genuinely not pay. Option C seems like the best, fairest option, where parents are asked to submit a proof of financial distress within 2 weeks, failing which the wards can be barred from attending classes, which is fair. You're getting 2 weeks, you prove that you have financial distress, otherwise you pay the fees, or else we'll not allow your children to attend the classes. So this seems fair and this is probably the best answer. Question number 14. Now this is quite tricky, as most of these factor-based questions are. So the Board of Trustees is concerned about the financial situation and has called Biswas for a meeting. And they've thought of these actions to improve finances: appeal to industrialists to donate, withhold salary of teachers, ask parents to pay up within a week or show proof of financial distress, stop online classes to signal the financial crunch, or start an extra section in every class and offer admission to whoever is willing to pay fees. I believe option D is the best answer. I'll tell you why. But you might not accept that, and that's completely fine because I do not have the official answers here. So appealing to industrialists to donate to the school seems completely fair, and it's probably the best possible thing you can do immediately, because that might involve an influx of a large amount of money, right? Because even if you have people paying in fees, that might not be a large amount of money as compared to what local industrialists might give. And that's completely fair to have P as the first option. As I've explained in the previous question, showing a proof of financial distress or asking them to pay up is a very, very good option to have. So then I have put R after P. Stopping online classes to signal the financial crunch is a fair option, and it seems like it can be the third best option here. As for withholding the teacher's salary, that is really something that should be done as a last resort means, because that's not a very good thing to do. Moreover, that might lead teachers to resign from the school, and that would only worsen situations. So that does not really work out. Option T, while it seems like it's a good option at first glance, it's not a sustainable option. You talk about adding an extra section so that you're offering admission to whoever is willing to pay fees. Now, this does a few problematic things, right? First of all, it's not sustainable because you cannot just create a section like that out of thin air. You can maybe do that in online classes, but then you will need infrastructure in offline classes to support those students too, which you have not thought about. So that's not sustainable at all. Moreover, that might also compromise the quality of students in the school, and that might also lead to this perception that the school only believes in money, and if you have money, you can enter the school and nothing else matters. So not a very good option to have. That's why that's ranked towards the end. So my answer for this is option number D, but might not be right. For question number 15, we see that teachers contribute to the reputation of the school. They are very important in arriving at critical decisions, and Biswas does not like them, right? He resents the involvement in the school matters because he has to listen to the collective voice and he cannot boss them around. So now he feels that he has an opportunity to get back at the teachers. He wants to reduce the salaries by 20% out of his own personal spite. So how can he best present the case? So we eliminate option number B and D very easily, right? Option B is about how experienced teachers may resign if there's a pay cut, which is obviously a terrible case to put forward because that will just ask the board to not reduce their salaries, because then they will just leave. Option D is not a good option either, because even if there is significant fat of the operating cost, it's obvious because schools basically have teachers and students and the infrastructure around it is mostly secondary. Teachers are most important, so obviously they are a significant part. That's not a good enough way to try and present a case to reduce their salaries, right? Option number E can also be eliminated because you're talking about teachers being punished for being alumni of the school, which is not a good message to send out. You're the alumni of the school, so we will punish you by reducing your salaries. Moreover, we talk about most of the teachers being alumni of the school, not all of them. So if you are creating a discriminatory practice that only past students of the school are being paid less, then that is clear discrimination. And if you're taking it out from all of them, then this justification does not even apply to all teachers, so it does not stand. Between option number A and C, C seems better because option A talks about how future leaders who are paying higher salaries to the teachers. This particular option is a good option to have, right? Because they are already paying higher salaries. So even if you reduce the amount of salary, it's fine. It's fine because the other schools are already paying less. However, I do not know any kind of a quantification here, right? I do not know how much higher salary. What if they are only paying a 5% higher salary while you are being asked to reduce 20% of their salaries? That does not seem like a very fair option then. As compared to that, option number C, while it does not work out always in a competitive setup, when you talk about competitors doing something, it might not always stand. It does seem like the best possible option for this particular thing. When you say two other well-known private schools in the city who are struggling to survive resorted to a pay cut, you're signaling two or three things, right? You're signaling, firstly, that it will not negatively impact the perception of the school, probably because the other reputed schools of the city have also done the same thing. Secondly, it also signals that the analysis that they are doing right now, the other schools must also have done, and they came to the conclusion that this is the best possible thing to do. So you're also relying on the wisdom of others. So that is also a factor that's taking place. So option C seems like the correct answer for this question. This was probably the simplest case in DM of SAT 2022, where you talk about how there's this particular R&D unit of a PSU, which has been established as a separate entity near the factory of the PSU. It has levels of hierarchy of scientists and they reside on the campus. All of the scientists, regardless of hierarchy, reside in a house that are similar in all aspects. Scientists are entitled to an HRA, that is house rent allowance, because that particular first car is far away from the city. But still, they are housed on the campus because they are so far away, right? The city and first car is very far away. That is why they are housed on campus. But they are still entitled to a house rent allowance because they are far away from the city and hence there is a commuting factor involved. The new recruits are provided a transit accommodation in the institute's studio apartments until vacant houses are available. And for these recruits, a queue has been created on the basis of the date of joining and not on the basis of hierarchy, with the most recent recruit going to the last in the queue. This execution of policy is the responsibility of the CAO who reports to the director. First question, Harsh Kohli resides in house number 324 and he has been wanting to move to the 2 series house because his mother-in-law, a chief scientist, lives alone over there. A few years back, he formally requested the CAO to allow him to move to a 2 series house whenever available. Recently, when house number 224 becomes vacant, he appeals to the CAO for that house, citing his earlier request. But there are already 5 scientists waiting in queue, and Sof Thangut is on the top of the queue. What is the best action CAO can take without violating the existing housing policy? This is a key word here. You do not want to violate the existing housing policy. So the only options really are option number A and C. Option B does not really make sense because the moment you do that, you're creating a new policy entirely, which does not make any sense. Option number D is very harsh and it does not allow for any kind of a satisfaction or gratification towards the stakeholder, that is Harsh Kohli. Option number E again does not make a lot of sense because Harsh had already submitted a particular request, and while this seems more or less fair, option C is a better option and we'll come to that. Option A is not in compliance with the existing housing policy, that is why we eliminate that. Now, option C seems like the best possible option because when you're doing that, you're allotting the house to Sof, who does not have a house right now. And you're asking Harsh to negotiate a swap with Sof. What you're doing here basically is that since we know that houses are already alike in all aspects, Sof might as well go and live in Harsh's house, whereas Harsh comes to 224 because he wants to live near his mother-in-law who is in 225. So this swap, when it happens, if and when it happens, will satisfy all parties at hand, right? It satisfies Harsh, who wants to live near the mother-in-law. It also satisfies Sof, who wants to live in a new house. But if Sof is very, very, stubborn that he wants to live in 224 only, then it is his right to live over there because of the housing policy. And if option number A is taken instead, then that would be violative of the housing policy. And that can obviously cause anger in Sof. So we do not want to choose that option. So option number C seems like the best possible option, where you take the role of a mediator and allow for all parties to be happy. In question 17, we see this person Ron, who has joined Firstcar recently and is placed third in the queue. He is temporarily housed in a studio apartment, but because that's too small, he cannot have his ailing parents live over there. But now, you know, he has this entire urgency that he needs them to come and live with him very quickly. So he approaches the CAO that he be moved up the queue on humanitarian grounds. What should the CAO do so that the CAO is perceived as most appropriate by all stakeholders at hand? So who are the stakeholders here? It is Ron himself, and it is the other scientists in the queue. Those are the stakeholders. Option A can be eliminated because it seems very harsh. Saying that nothing can be done because violation of rules will set a wrong precedence is fair, but it's harsh because Ron has a genuine interest here. He has a genuine case. He has a genuine necessity to be moved there. So that could be just too harsh. Option B is completely unfair when you move him to the top of the queue, making a rule that parents are scientists with ailing parents will be given a preference. That is changing the policy, and that is unfair to the scientists who are already there in the queue. Option C is not sustainable, because if you try to facilitate Ron in getting a house in the city with free accommodation for the first 3 months, then that might not be very sustainable, because what after the 3 months? After the 3 months, what if he still does not get a house? Then he'll have to keep commuting. And moreover, the entire process might just be too difficult. But C is not a bad option overall. C could be a good option. Option D is definitely eliminated because you are trying to shock off responsibility and giving it away to the director. So that does not work out. Option E again takes a mediator role and seems like the best possible option. By trying to get at the consensus of the two scientists ahead, we basically leave it to the parties at hand to take the best possible decision here. Here, if the scientists are considerate enough, then they will understand Ron, and they will understand that he has ailing parents and he has necessities, and they'll allow him. And if they were not going to allow him anyway, then they'll not allow him. But if you had actually, moved him to the top of the queue, even without informing these scientists or even without taking their views into consideration, then they might have been enraged by that, and they might try to protest that. So instead of that arising as a possibility, asking for a negotiation to take place is a much better option. In number 18, we see that the CEO has received requests from the residents of three series houses to move to other section houses. He is aware that this is because of the factory nearby, which is very noisy. But the housing is very limited also. So he has to do something before the problem worsens. How does he make the life of the three series residents more comfortable? Now, this was slightly tricky as compared to the previous two questions. The first one is offering a higher HRA to the three series residents, nudging them to move to the city. This is not a sustainable option, because if you do that, if you're successful in doing that, if you're successful in nudging these citizens to move to the city, then that's not a great option to do, because that would basically make your houses here redundant. So you have obviously spent a lot of money in the construction of these houses, and now you're saying that you do not want anybody to live there, which is not financially sound decision to make. Option number B is about providing these residents with a hardship allowance of 15% of basic salary. This seems like an okay option, but not really great as such, because that does not really make their life comfortable, right? It's kind of paying them a certain money as compensation, but it's not making their lives comfortable. Option C is about installing expensive soundproof windows. Now, the word expensive might throw you off, but expensive here might be a fair expense to make, because as compared to a 15% of salary being paid indefinitely, it might just be better to install expensive soundproof windows and be done with it. Because after that, the lives of these people becomes more comfortable. They do not have a problem with the noisy factory. They do not have to be compensated anymore. At the same time, people do not have a problem living in those houses. So it seems like a fair expense to make. Option D is completely thrown out, because you cannot really, you know, imagine that factory will work only for 5 days instead of 7 days because people are complaining about the noise. That's not really very smart as a decision to make. Option C is much better. And option E talks about an accelerated promotion, which is a discriminatory practice, right? If you're living in a bad place, then you're being given promotion. Not a very fair kind of an argument to make. The next case is of Korkai, a village which is in a small island which is separated from the mainland, and how a boat ride is the only mode of transport to the mainland. Here there's Budugu, our protagonist, who ferries people, cattle and bicycles in his boat for a living. There is a remoteness and lack of connection to the mainland which has served him well. Right, obviously, because he is a boatman, he's obviously happy in this situation. He has a family of five. He has two daughters who are studying in a city college and have dreams of corporate jobs. And his ailing mother and wife complete the family. Now, he had sent his daughters to study in the city because there's only one school in Korkai, which is run by an NGO. The NGO prepares the village kids for higher studies. For those who cannot go to the cities, the NGO teaches them about the virtues of the local way of life. So like, you either go to the cities or you're taught that local way of life is also great, so you can live here in peace and harmony also. He's a member of the village panchayat, and you know, people just don't know the MLA or MP because they are obviously not very connected. Suddenly one day the MLA visits and says that the MLA has changed his plan for the region. That is, a bridge will be connected to the mainland and now real estate development will take place in the island. She announces that the island will become a well-known eco-tourism destination. She stresses that the local livelihood, which is dependent on fortunes at the sea, might enjoy the certainty in minimum wages meted out by eco-resort owners. Basically, what this line means is that now people who earlier had to rely on, you know, whether or not they're able to catch fish, will now enjoy certain wages from the eco-resort owners who will employ these local people. But some villagers fear that the bridge will irreversibly change their lives and livelihoods. Important line. So the first question here was that Budugu fears that the proposed bridge will leave him jobless, and he is determined to do something about it. Right? Because he was obviously benefiting from the boatman job. Now why does he want a bridge to come up, which will basically render him unemployed? Now, how does he gather effective support to get the construction of the proposed bridge delayed? Option number A can be eliminated because there is no point to a hunger strike if there is no media to cover it. There is no point if you sit on a hunger strike because people are just not there to cover it. People do not care enough about your hunger strike, so it does not make a lot of sense to do that. You're too disconnected from the mainland world to be taken in that light seriously. Option number C can be eliminated because the moment you do something like that, you're alienating the villagers, you're turning them hostile towards you, and instead of supporting your cause, they might just support the bridge, because why should they be, you know, reliant on a boatman when a bridge can be made in a few years or in a few months, and then they would not really have to rely on the boatman anymore. Moreover, he's not the only boatman on the island. There's no way to prove something like that happens. So there's no way that his suspending the boat services is actually going to be threat enough. Option number E is about getting a resolution passed by the panchayat that the bridge will ruin the local way of life, which again does not really make much of a difference. What if the panchayat makes such a resolution passed? That does not really mean that there's effective support to get the construction of the proposed bridge delayed. Either option B or D should be the correct option. In B, you inform environmental experts that the state is home to rare fish, frogs and turtles, which might actually lead to them rallying for your cause, right? And that might lead to external support. However, this is contingent on a few factors and assumptions. This has the assumption that in fact he is being truthful about it. In fact, he is not lying that there are rare fish, frogs and turtles, right? And again, rare does not mean endangered, and there are many assumptions that have to be taken here. So option D seems better, where you're partnering with the local NGO and campaigning that the developments will ruin the local way of life. This is also better than E, because when you're partnering with the local NGO and campaigning that, then probably you're also targeting children. You're also targeting their parents. You're targeting normal islanders, and you're campaigning that the developments will ruin the local way of life, which is better than getting a resolution passed. So D seems like the most feasible option to gather effective support. In question number 20, you have the MLA being worried about the resistance. Now, like her other successful projects, she was supposed to gather a lot of funding because of this. Moreover, she would try to be the face of development in the state, and maybe she would even become a minister because of that. But Budugu's activism has cast the project in a very bad light among popular minds. So she wants to protect her pro-development image. What can the MLA do? Option one does not really work out very well, because when you talk about discrediting him in a public meeting and announcing that he's putting his interests ahead of that of his village development, that might not sit well with all people. Moreover, people might not believe her, right? Because obviously she has to gain by discrediting Gudugu. So then the thing becomes that if she tries to do something like that, people might just not believe her. So this is not a very strong option. Option number D does not work out at all, because when she does that, she's clearly running away from the problem entirely, right? She's trying to find alternative land. So she's completely evading the island. And that might not be a good course of action. Option E might not work out either, because fishermen and boat rowers might realize that even if the MLA is doing it right now in the short term, they care more about a long-term sustainable solution, and some money is not going to fix it. Option C talks about publicizing that the project will improve socio-economic condition of the island. Now, while this seems like an okay option, we understand that since publicity is there, but at the same time, Budugu is also publicizing something, his activism is also going on, that publicity might not be effective. As compared to that, option B seems like the better option, where you're inviting the panchayat for a discussion on a possible compromise solution. So here you're dealing with the villagers directly, you're dealing with Budugu directly, and hence you might come to the best possible solution. So this might be the first step. Based on how the discussion goes, then she can take another step. For the final question, we have that Budugu becomes a well-known social activist with a lot of followers. Pragati, the elder daughter, completes education and looks for employment, but several well-known corporates refuse her a job because of her father's anti-development stand. How does she communicate that she has a separate identity of her own? The first option is to stop using her last name in her job applications. Now, that might just not work out, right? Because just not using your last name does not really separate you from your father. It does not really create a distinct identity, particularly because if you are popular enough to be known like that, even without the use of your last name, you might be identified. Moreover, that does not work out entirely, because for your job applications, you might not use it, but later on, you might have to use it for some other verification. Overall, not a very sustainable option. Option number C completely does not work out, because option number C, you're talking about supporting the proposed development. You're going against your father here. And obviously, Pragati is not somebody, probably not somebody who would, go against her father in that way directly. Because that would be a very unethical thing to do on her part. For her job, she's trying to discredit her father. That's not a very good thing to do, and we'll not select this option. Option number E might be correct when you talk about how her father's activism is misconstrued by certain corporates. In fact, I'll say this is possibly the correct answer also, because when you do that, you're trying to explain that her father is not actually anti-development, he has other stands, and that might work out. But again, there's a contingency here that it might work out, it might not work out, corporates might or might not agree with whatever she explains here. Option number B does not work at all, because that does not really show her distinct identity. Option number D, though not very strong, seems like a good way to prove that she has a distinct identity. By promoting her accolades and awards, she's trying to signal that she has certain achievements and she has an identity ahead of her father, and that might be a good option. So it's either D or it's E, but D seems like a better option with less amount of a contingency factor. So it's going to be one of these probably. Yeah, so again, reminding, none of these answers are official, and this is what I believe were the correct options. So let's see, all the best for your exact results. Bye bye.